मॉर्निंग क्लास. इन यस्टरडेज लेक्चर वी आर डिस्कसिंग कोरोजन इन मेटल्स. सो टेक्निकली कोरोजन इन मेटल इज बेसिकली एन इलेक्ट्रोकेमिकल रिएक्शन एंड वी नो एन इलेक्ट्रोकेमिकल रिएक्शन इज नथिंग बट एन ऑक्सीडेशन रिडक्शन रिएक्शन. सो इफ देर आर टू डिसिमिलर metals which are in physical contact with each other, then one of the metal will undergo an oxidation reaction while the other one will undergo a reduction reaction. Metals which has tendency to give up electrons will get oxidized, while the metals which has tendency to accept electrons will undergo a reduction. Generally, out of the two metals, which one will undergo oxidation and which one will undergo reduction, it will be decided by the corresponding electrochemical potential of those metals. So, in order to measure the electrochemical potential, what we use is a standard half cell. What exactly the standard half cell is? It is nothing but a metal plate kept in a standard electrolyte of the same ion. What does it mean? For example, if I have a copper plate, then the solution in which I will dip the copper plate will also be an electrolyte of copper. So, as shown in the schematic diagram, we have a copper plate and it is being kept in 1 molar strength of Cu2 plus solution. Likewise, on the other side, we have an iron plate and it is being kept in the solution of 1 molar strength of iron electrolyte. And if we now electrically connect these two plates through a voltmeter, then what you can see is the voltmeter will going to show you some non-zero voltage. This non-zero voltage is representing the electrode potential of this standard cell. Remember, larger is the electrode potential, greater will be the rate of corrosion. So, in order to minimize the corrosion, what you should do is you should always try to work with metals which has lower electrode potential. In fact, this electrode potential is representing the potential difference between the two half cells. So, smaller is the difference, smaller will be the amount of current that will flow from one side to the other side, and that will reduce the electrochemical reaction happening on either sides. In this particular case, Cu2 plus in the medium, that is in the electrolyte, accepts the electrons and gets converted into Cu neutral, that gets deposited on the copper plate. So that means on the right hand side in the electrochemical cell, the deposition of copper takes place from the electrolyte onto the copper plate. While on the other side, iron from the iron plate liberates 2 electrons to the external circuit, and in the process it gets converted into Fe2 plus and it goes into the electrolytic solution. Apart from the transfer of electron in the external circuit and the oxidation reduction reaction at the metal plates, some diffusion of metal atoms from 2 different electrolytes also takes place across the membrane. Now, in order to define out of the two, which metal will act as an anode and which one will act as cathode, that means which one will undergo an oxidation and which one will undergo reduction, what you need to do is you need to measure the galvanic potential of every metal. Now, what exactly the galvanic potential is? Galvanic potential is nothing but the potential difference which the metal exhibits when they are in electrical contact with each other. Say, for example, in the previous slide, what we had is copper and iron were electrically connected to each other. So, this is nothing but the galvanic couple, and the cell which we have schematically shown here is also referred as the galvanic cell. So, if there are two half cells connected together, the overall complete cell is referred as the galvanic cell. Now, in a galvanic cell, there are two dissimilar metals which is in electrical contact, and they forms something called a galvanic couple. So, galvanic couple is nothing but two opposite metals or two dissimilar metals are in electrical contact with each other, then it forms a galvanic couple. And it is being kept in an electrolyte in a galvanic cell. So, your galvanic cell has basically two components, an electrolyte and a galvanic couple. Now, whenever you have a galvanic couple, one of the metal will corrode. Which one will corrode? The one which is sitting at the anode, or you can say the one which makes an anode in the galvanic cell. While nothing will happen to the cathode, because cathode undergoes a reduction reaction. So your cathode remains protected and your anode undergoes an oxidation. Whenever you have an anode and cathode made up of two dissimilar material or metals, it generates an electric potential across it, and for different galvanic couples, this potential is different. For example, if I have a junction between copper and iron, the one that we have discussed in the previous slide, the galvanic potential is 0.78. But instead, if I replace copper with zinc and make another couple of iron and zinc, then you can see that for such a couple, your galvanic potential will be different from what you had in the previous case. For iron zinc, this number is only 0.323. What does it mean? It means that if you have a galvanic couple which is made up of copper and iron, then that galvanic couple is more susceptible to oxidation as compared to if you have a junction of iron and zinc. Why I am saying so? It is because smaller is the electrode potential difference, lesser will be the material susceptibility to undergo an oxidation reduction reaction, or you can say the corrosion. One more important thing is, if you look in the previous expression, the first one between copper and iron, what you can see is the Cu2 plus in that particular case, Cu2 plus accepts the two incoming electron and gets converted into copper. That means copper was undergoing the reduction while the iron was giving up the electron and was eventually getting converted into Fe2+. That means iron was oxidizing from Fe0 to Fe2+. So, if I ask you who won out of the two, which one is anode and which one is cathode, your answer would be the one that undergoes reduction is your cathode. So in this case, copper was cathode, and the one that undergoes oxidation is anode. So iron was anode. But compared to this, if you look at the second equation, where you have Fe2 plus accepting two incoming electrons and gets converted into Fe0, that means Fe is undergoing a reduction reaction and it is acting as a cathode. While zinc from Zn gets converted into Zn2 plus, that means it is undergoing an oxidation reduction reaction and it is undergoing an oxidation. So it is an anode. What is my point? My point is, in the previous case, iron was undergoing oxidation and hence it was anode, while in the second case, iron undergoes a reduction and hence it is a cathode. What does it mean? It means that no metal is permanently acting as anode or cathode. Whether a particular metal will undergo an oxidation reaction or a reduction reaction depends with which other metal it is making a junction. So the electrode potential of these two metals will decide out of the two which will undergo an oxidation reaction and which one will undergo a reduction reaction. Point number one. Point number two is, smaller is the electrode potential difference between the two metals, lesser will be the rate of reaction of electrochemical process. That means the one with smaller electrode potential difference will corrode less as compared to the one with larger electrode potential. So, in the two equations, the first one has electrode potential difference of 0.78 volt, while the second one has only 0.32 volt. That means the junction between copper and iron, the first case, is more susceptible to corrosion as compared to iron and zinc. If you remember, if you put zinc into iron, what we got is a galvanized steel. And galvanized steel generally do not corrode much as compared to the native iron, which is junction with the copper. Any doubt up to this point? Okay, I guess there are no doubts up to this point. So let's proceed. As I was explaining, out of the two metals, one will always act as anode, while the other one will going to act as cathode. And which one will act as anode and the other one will act as cathode, that depends on the standard electrode potential value of the given metal. So in this particular table, we have mentioned the electrode reaction and corresponding standard electrode potential for those metals. So you can see in the table, your topmost entry is Au3+. That means the gold undergoing a reduction reaction, and corresponding to this, your standard electrode potential is 1.42 plus 1.42. And if you look into the table, as you go downward, what you can see is from gold to potassium, as you go down, you can see the value of your standard electrode potential also decreases. What does this mean? As the standard electrode potential decreases, the material becomes more and more susceptible to oxidation. That means it is more likely to undergo an oxidation reaction or you can say it is likely to act as anode. While the one which is having higher standard electrode potential will likely to be more inert and will act as cathode. So, in a given circumstances, if two metals are named to you, you have to see out of the two, the one which is sitting higher on the electrode potential scale will undergo a reduction reaction, and the one that sits lower on the series will undergo a reduction reaction. For example, in the previous two cases, we referred the iron Fe2+. So, with reference to this, you have to see where the copper sits and where the zinc sits. So, if I mark copper on the same table, you can see copper is here. So, with reference to iron or say ferrous, copper sits higher on the electrochemical series. This table is called the electrochemical series. So, out of the two, the one that sits on the upper side is acting as cathode. So, in the first case, we have copper that is acting as the cathode, while the iron becomes anode in the first case. While in the second case, which I am marking with the red color, you have a junction of iron and zinc. Now, if you focus on zinc, zinc is relatively lower on an electrochemical series vis-a-vis to iron. So, the one which is now lower on the electrochemical series, right, will act as an anode. So, in this case, your iron will act as anode. No, sorry, zinc will act as anode, while the iron becomes cathode for this particular set of junction. So, have you got the idea? What you should remember is, larger is the standard electrode potential. That means the metal sits on the upper side of the standard electrode potential series or galvanic series. That material will act as cathode, and the one that sits lower on this table will act as anode. Remember, cathode undergoes reduction and remains protected. Anode undergoes oxidation and gets corrode. Is it clear? Okay, if there are no doubts at this point, let's proceed further. So, what you can see here is the chemistry of iron undergoing an oxidation reaction with the zinc. So, what happens is when the metal ions undergoes a corrosion in an acidic environment, that means you keep the zinc plate around an oxidizing environment, which is an H+ ion, or you can say an acidic environment, zinc will get converted into Zn2+ and goes into the acidic solution. The same thing that I have explained in the previous expressions for iron, now the same thing is happening for zinc. So, zinc liberates the 2 electron and gets converted into Zn2+. The oxidation or rusting of iron in water. If you have a piece of iron kept in the water, then in the presence of the dissolved oxygen which is present in the water, iron undergoes an oxidation reaction and gets converted into iron hydroxide. So whenever you have iron reacting with dissolved oxygen in the aqueous medium, it forms the basic solution of iron hydroxide. Similarly, if you have an Fe3 plus, that is instead of a ferrous, if you have a ferric ion, then it will also produce FeOH thrice instead of FeOH twice. Remember, in both the cases, the reaction takes place in the basic environment. So this expression also gives you the hydroxide. So both ferrous or ferric will ultimately undergo an oxidation reaction and forms a basic solution. Generally, in layman's language, when iron undergoes corrosion through an oxidation reaction, you end up with ferrous or ferric hydrous. And this ferrous or ferric hydrous is nothing but the common rust. So the red color rust that we commonly see on the surface of iron is nothing but this ferrous or ferric hydrous. This we have already discussed. What you should remember is the metal which sits higher on the electrochemical series will undergo a reduction reaction and act as cathode, while the one that sits lower on the electrode series will act as anode and will undergo an oxidation reaction. So for example, for the previous two cases, we consider Fe2 plus and Fe3 plus vis-a-vis to zinc. So this is the standard potential for Fe2 plus. Sorry, on the right hand side also there should be Fe3 plus. So there is a typing mistake here. This should be, no, this is true. This is correct because it is reacting with only one electron. So Fe3 plus when reacts with single electron gets converted into Fe2 plus. And likewise, Fe2 plus reacts to two electrons, then it will gets converted into a neutral ion. So the series given is correct. My overall point is, if you have a junction between gold and potassium, then gold higher on the electrochemical series will act as cathode and potassium lower in the electrochemical series will act as anode. Instead, let us say if we have a junction between lead and aluminium, then aluminium being lower in the electrochemical series, your aluminium in this case will act as anode, while your lead will become cathode. Is it clear? So anytime when you are supposed to decide out of the two metal which will undergo an anodic reaction and which one will undergo a cathodic reaction, you should look at the standard electrode potential for those metals. Larger is the value, that means more positive, the metal will act as cathode. Smaller is the standard electrode potential, that is towards zero or maybe negative, it will act as anode. This is the same thing. This time the galvanic series is for alloys also. For example, if you have brass, brass is basically an alloy of copper and zinc, and if you make a junction of this with, say, iron, that means you have a junction of brass with iron, then you can see brass is sitting higher on the electrochemical series, so it will act as cathode, while iron, being lower on the electrochemical series, will act as anode. So you can decide for any metal or their alloys for becoming a cathode or an anode. Now, once you know out of the two metal which will undergo a cathodic reaction and which one will undergo an anodic reaction, then the next important term that you need to understand for the corrosion reaction is what will be the rate of this corrosion. So to measure the rate of corrosion, you need to define a quantity which is called corrosion penetration rate or CPR. This corrosion penetration rate or CPR is equal to, CPR is equal to Kw upon rho At, where K is the proportionality constant, W is weight loss after exposure to the corrosive environment time T. That means if I open the surface of a metal in some corrosive environment and wait for some time T, let's say 10 days, T is my 10 days, then whatever is the loss in material's weight that has happened is being referred as W. Rho is the density of the material and A is the exposed area of the specimen. Remember, here the important term is the exposed area. If some of the surface of the material is covered and not exposed to the corrosive environment, then you will not going to consider that particular area in your calculation. You should consider only that surface which is open to the environment. So, A is the exposed specimen area. From this expression, you can clearly see your CPR is directly proportional to the omega, that is the weight loss happen in the material, and your CPR is inversely proportional to the exposed specimen area. So here is the idea. If you can somehow increase the exposed surface area, that means your A becomes large, then you can have the lower value of CPR, because your denominator is large, then your CPR will be less. So one idea which you can implement in your design is the material which will act as anode, the one that will undergo corrosion, should have larger area, because larger area will reduce its corrosion rate. And if you can reduce the corrosion rate, you can increase the life of your product. Another important thing is you can also measure the corrosion rate in terms of the electrical current of the electrochemical reaction. You know, if you have junction of two dissimilar metal, you have flow of electron that is happening from one metal to the other, and that flow of electron is nothing but it is constituting a small current. If you measure this magnitude of the current, you can also define the corrosion rate in terms of this current. It is being defined as the corrosion rate R is equal to I upon NF, where I is the electric current because of the electrochemical reaction. N is the number of electrons which is participating in given electrochemical reaction. For example, I have ferrous, that is Fe2 plus gets converted into Fe, my N will be equal to 2. But instead, I have gold, that is Au3 plus getting converted into Au0, then my N equal to 3. So N you can also consider to be the valency of the metal which is undergoing an oxidation reaction. And F is basically the Faraday's constant, you know, it's a universal constant. So what you can see from this expression is the corrosion rate is directly proportional to the current of an electrochemical reaction. So this is another idea. In a given metal junction, if you can somehow reduce the magnitude of the electrochemical current, then it can also reduce the rate of corrosion. And remember, current is actually flowing across the surface or say cross-sectional area of the anode. So when you are increasing the cross-sectional area of the anode, you are actually reducing the current density, and because of that, your overall current reduces, which results into lower corrosion rate. So one thing as a design engineer we should keep in mind is, if I have larger anode area, I can reduce the magnitude of electrode current, and that can reduce my rate of corrosion. Any doubt in the definition of the corrosion rate?
No, sir.
Okay, let's proceed further. So far what we have understood is the science behind the process of corrosion, its chemistry, and the quantity in which you can measure the corrosion. Now the next important question is, as a design engineer, what we want is, under ideal circumstances, metal should not at all undergo corrosion. But corrosion is a universal process and you cannot stop it 100%. So what we should do is, we should minimize the rate of corrosion so that we can have an extended life of our engineering product. So how one can reduce the rate of corrosion for given material? So the process by which you can reduce the rate of corrosion is called passivity. The process is called passivity. In passivation of a metal, what we generally do is, we try to modify the material's property whose oxidation we want to prevent. So for example, the most common way of passivating the material surface is by putting a paint on the surface of steel. Wherever we use steel in our domestic application, the easiest way to prevent the corrosion of steel is, you paint it, the thin layer of the paint will act as the protective layer and it passivates the inner surface of the metal. The other more sophisticated way of preventing the corrosion of given material is by making them inert. So how can you make a material inert? To do so, what you should do is, you should make alloying of your given material with other materials which have tendency to passivate the materials. So if you make alloys of chromium, iron, nickel, titanium and many other alloys, then generally it passivates the alloy and overall the alloy becomes less susceptible to corrosion. Why this is happening? This is happening because you are putting a material in the product which is more electrochemically inert. That means it is more prone to act as cathode. So one way to passivate the material is make the material which you want to protect as a cathode. So apart from making the material cathode and passivating its surface by a protective layer like paint, we will going to use many other means by which you can minimize the rate of corrosion. So we will take a couple of examples, and in every example we will talk about the means by which you can passivate the material or indirectly prevents its corrosion. So let's proceed further. Now what we will do is we will talk about different types of corrosion. As you know, corrosion itself is a subject. It is very important for chemical engineers, but for us, we are simply taking an overview of this science. So we will not consider it in toto. Rather, we will talk about few important corrosion types. So we will going to discuss 11 subtypes of corrosion which is important for industrial purpose, and most of the industrial solids undergo corrosion by either of these means. So we will going to discuss in detail 11 different types of corrosion. Simultaneously, I will also propose solutions to prevent these sub types of corrosion. So we will start our discussion with the first type of corrosion, which is being referred as uniform or general attack corrosion. So what exactly uniform or general attack corrosion is? As the name suggests, your uniform or general attack corrosion is the one which corrodes the material uniformly throughout on its surface. That means the entire surface of the material which is exposed to the corrosive environment will undergo corrosion uniformly. The outcome of such corrosion is it leaves behind scale or deposit. You remember, scale or deposit is nothing but the rusting byproduct. Something like the red color material that we see on the surface of iron. So that is your example of uniform corrosion. So you can give example like general rusting in iron. It is the uniform corrosion, or you can have another common example is the silverware. If you have a silver material, you must have seen the silver becomes dull when it is exposed to the air. So the tarnishing of silverware is also because of the fine layer of formation of silver oxide. So silver oxide, basically the reason that tarnishes the lustrous characteristic of the silver. In fact, this uniform or general attack corrosion is the greatest destruction in metals. All metals undergo corrosion by these means. Apart from the greatest destruction this type of corrosion causes in metals, it is also most common form of corrosion. That means most likely the metal is likely to undergo corrosion by this mean. But you need not to bother much about this, because despite it is being causing the greatest destruction and most common, it is also the least objectionable kind of corrosion. Why I am saying it is least objectionable? Because you can predict the corrosion rate when caused by the uniform corrosion or general attack corrosion. That means you can use mathematical models which will give you an exact idea about the rate at which the corrosion will take place. And hence, if you are designing a product for a given lifetime, you can put your corrective parameters in the design so that although the material undergoes corrosion, but it do not hinder the performance of the product. Why it is so? Because you will then use the technical parameters of the material in a way, despite of corrosion, it do not negatively impact its performance. Now comes to the prevention methods. If somebody asks me how you can minimize or prevent the material from undergoing the uniform corrosion, so basically there are three different ways by which you can do this. The first one, which I have just previously explained, make a protective coating. The most common form of protective coating is paint the surface. The other most sophisticated ways is you can create a thin film, some form of lamination on the surface of the material, so that thin protective laminated surface will also protect the inner material from undergoing the corrosion. In either case, the protection is being provided by the protective coating. The more sophisticated way to prevent uniform corrosion is by using materials that act as inhibitors. Now, what are these inhibitors? Inhibitors are the materials which has lower electrode potential. That means they are electrochemically more inert and the rate of corrosion is much lower. So if you specifically use materials in your design which are inhibitors or which are unlikely to undergo corrosion, then you can minimize the rate of corrosion in your overall product. The third mean by which you can minimize the rate of corrosion is through cathodic protection. What we have understood previously is, if you have junction of two dissimilar material, the one which is cathode will remain protected. So if you want to protect corrosion of a particular metal, you should connect it in a way that particular metal becomes the cathode, and hence in the junction it will remain protected. So these are the means by which you can protect the material from undergoing uniform corrosion. Since we are running out of time now, I am stopping at this point. The remaining examples, we will discuss it in tomorrow's class.